I'm trying to think of a Lockheed tech rep that was at Beale. Paul Mellinger.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure you know Paul.
Sure.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you a question because I told this to somebody else and they didn't... I could have swore I was in Paul's office one time and he had a manual and it showed a dash capability of 3.5. You ever heard of that?
No, only from Brian Schull.
Bro, Brian Schull said that?
In one of his... Well, he one didn't say that, but he said... Yeah, he implied that.
He implied that, huh?
Yeah, that mission over Libya.
Oh, okay.
Okay,
quite so, a lot of things.
Yeah, right, well,
so
yeah.
Today's April 5th of 2016 in Carlsbad, California, interviewing Bill Weaver, former pilot for United States Air Force and for Lockheed as a test pilot. So let's start. Where were you born?
In L.A., Los Angeles, Hollywood Hospital.
What year?
1928, December 6, 1928.
All right. So you went to school in Los Angeles. Where'd you go to college?
Hollywood High and then UCLA for a year. And I did really want to go to the Naval Academy. I had an uncle who was a commander in the Navy. And he was stationed over at Pearl Harbor before the war, okay. He and my aunt. And luckily, I was able to get into the Academy. I was a second alternate. I applied through my congressman. So,
you graduated from the academy when?
June 1st, 1951.
And then you went to Air Force pilot training.
That's right. At that time, in those years, it was shortly after the Air Force had become a separate branch of the service. And that was in 1947. And starting with a class of Naval Academy class of 49, they started the procedure of taking 25% of the graduating class from West Point and Annapolis and putting them in the Air Force.
So some of the other people who went to the Air Force Academy after being in the Naval Academy would be names you can think of.
You mentioned one.
You know, Bill Anders, the astronaut.
Bill Anders, yeah. Okay. Bob Gilliland was a prominent Naval Academy graduate who went in the Air Force, and he flew the first flight on the SR.
So we're getting ahead of ourselves here. One thing I forgot to mention is that we have two SR-71 pilots here. I'll pass Bill Weaver and Maury Rosenberg, who we've done an interview before. So we have the opportunity to have two guys who flew the same airplane, the same fantastic airplane, to talk about it. But first, we're going to talk to Bill a little bit more about his experience and how he got there, and which leads to the next question. So what did you fly in the Air Force? Oh, first of all, what class were you in?
52 Easy, it's called. What were you in?
66G.
66G.
So and we have our 50-year reunion next month.
well, that'll be a good one.
Yeah.
We shouldn't go. There's just a bunch of old guys.
I know.
Not like us.
Well, that's right. You were in the class.
We were in the same pilot training class. We were roommates, Ron and I.
Oh, be damned. That's
great. And in OTS, we were roommates. F4 school.
Oh, be darn.
Yeah. I can't get rid of him.
Can't shake the guy, huh?
Well, when it got to flying serious airplanes, he stayed in, I got out. So I left after my 4 years or whatever it was, or five years. So
yeah.
Try not to bump the table.
I know.
Moving the thing all over the place. Okay, so when you graduated from pilot, where did you go to pilot training?
Hondo, Texas. It is a World War II base. It's about 40 miles west of San Antonio. And
was that one of the alternate fields we had?
Yes. We were in pilot training?
Yeah.
I think it was. Hondo was an alternate.
I remember that name.
I do too.
Near scenic Brackettville or Uvalde or one of those god-awful places?
A lot of god-awful places.
I think they still have that sign there that says, home of John Nance Garner. You know, remember that when you drive through Uvalde? You go, who knows that?
Yeah, before we got into my class, got into Hunter, they just reopened it after had been shut down and was a chicken ranch or something. They moved the chickens out and moved us into the barracks, same barracks.
As the chickens.
As the chickens, the roosters.
Where did you fly there?
T-6. We started out in a T-6. And that was my first real experience with flying an airplane. When I went to the academy during plebe summer, they gave us little indoctrination rides in N3Ns on float, the old Stearman N3N on floats.
Oh, wow.
And just kind of a little introduction to flying if you didn't have, if you hadn't had one either, and I hadn't. Yeah. So, and they had these salty old guys, chiefs, flying chiefs. They weren't officers, but they were characters, and the guy I had was terrific. So I went up and did a nice half-hour cruise around the Chesapeake Bay, mostly sightseeing, and he asked me how I felt, and I said, God, great, this is terrific, beautiful. I said, feeling okay? And I said, yeah, I feel good. He's like, okay, split ass rolls. And about 5 minutes into that, I upchucked. And that was my introduction to flying. Very inauspicious beginning.
How did you talk back and forth?
That's a good question. We had a tin can or something. No, we had communication. I was in the back, he was in the front. And I don't remember. All I remember was he asked me how I felt, and I gave him the wrong answer.
So after flying the T-6, did you go up to change airplanes there? Did they go to the T-Bird at that time?
No, you're in Hondo for 6 months. You got started the training actually August, and then January, I think it was the end of January, February, went to advanced flight training at Williams Air Force Base in right outside of Phoenix, and had another, another 100 hours in the T-6 there, I think.
Really?
And then into the T-33 and the P-80, at that time P-80, when it became the F-80, the first operational jet for the Air Force.
So you flew the T-33 for a while, and then I guess when you started doing gunnery and that kind of stuff, you switched to the P-80.
No, it was just advanced flight training.
Okay.
And then when we finished that program, and it was I think it was about August of '52, we graduated from and got our wings at Williams. After completing the advanced training program, and went right to Luke Air Force Base for gunnery training. And that was, took us up to November. And that was in F-84s. That was where I had my introduction to the F-84. And it wasn't very impressive. We had the old F-84 Bs and Cs, and they were very underpowered. And it was also a lot of foreign students. That military assistance program, the MAP program, was in effect, and the U.S. was providing flight training, basic and advanced, to foreign. We had Frenchmen, we had Dutchmen, we had Norwegians mixed in with our class, except the foreign students got the F-84G, the advanced airplane. Plenty of thrust, beautiful. We Americans got the crummy old ones,
yeah.
B's and C's.
So what was your assignment out of Williams, or out of Luke, I mean?
Korea, yeah. I have an interesting story about Luke in August, in the 115 degree heat,
yeah.
In these underpowered airplanes. My instructor said, We don't have a lot of excess thrust in this airplane, and on these hot days, you're going to use up a lot of the runway. It's 10,000 foot runway, and I said, so I expected that, but it was about 110, and
morning time.
Yeah, right. My first flight in a real fighter, and went roaring down the runway at Luke. Got to the end, and still didn't have takeoff speed, and a 1,000-foot runway, overrun, I mean. And I went into that, and I decided as the fence was coming up, I better pull back, and still a little on the slow side, and kind of shook my way over that fence. And he didn't tell me it, the extent of the issue here. Anyway, it was okay after we got the flying speed and climb speed and got up to about 24,000 feet and heard this big bang and the canopy went flying back. And he forgot to tell me about that characteristic also. They had bad canopy seals.
Oh, geez.
In my first flight, I was not real impressed, but got through all that gunnery and, you know, strafing, bombing, a lot of fun. Then so I went to Korea.
When did you get to Korea?
December of 52.
You went from the hottest place in the world to
the coldest place. Yeah.
With the wind blowing.
Oh, that was miserable.
So you were flying F-84?
Then we had the F-84G in Korea, and that was really great.
Is that a straight-wing airplane?
It was straight-wing, yeah.
Yeah. When did they go to the swept-back
lanes? That was the, yeah, the...
86s?
No, that was... they had a 84F.
Oh, they did?
The swept-wing, yeah. 84G, and then the 84F and the swept-wing, and it was never a real success. But and they didn't build too many of them.
So were you? So now you get there in November 52?
December 52.
December 52.
And...
which base?
K2, Taegu, down south, Taegu, Korea.
So what was the mission down there?
It was, you know, close air support and bombing the supply routes and railroad tracks and trains if we could find them.
The war was still going on, wasn't it? That's right. I mean, the war was going on then, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it was going on until the armistice, which I think was late July of 53.
Yeah. So you flew for 6 or 7 months of combat.
Right. I had 89 missions when the armistice came through. The normal was 100 was a
so it was
standard tour. I almost got there, but not quite.
So it was a close air support mission, talking to a ground pack most of the time?
Sometimes, yeah, most of the time. And yeah. not most of the times. But... and then sometimes the weather was bad. We had controlled drops, radar controlled drops, you know, flying tight formation, you know, and go clouds underneath us, and they'd guide us in to wherever the target was. So. But most of it was close air support.
Wow. Did you ever get to shoot up a train?
I shot, no, darn it, I never did. I was always hoping to do that. Shot up trucks and things, but a train would have been perfect. I love those World War II films with train locomotive blowing up. I always aspired to that, but I never got it.
What was the, what did the airplane have, 50 calibers or 20 millimeters? Or
50 calibers.
50. Four, six?
Four.
Okay. Yeah. Could you actually feel them go off?
Yeah, you feel
it.
Not like the 104, which had the 20-millimeter Gatling gun, right. 4,000 rounds a minute.
The reason I ask is I recently interviewed a P-47 pilot.
Oh, yeah.
And he said on a strafe when he fired all 8 guns at once, the airplane slowed 20 miles an hour.
Holy is that cow. Right? Wow.
When did you come home?
Let's see, September... 53, and when we came back, they said, all you returning war heroes can have your choice of Air Force command and area that you'd like to go to for reassignment.
Cool.
Sounded good to me. I wanted to go to either Luke in Arizona, Luke Air Force Base,
right.
For gunnery, as a gunnery instructor, or go to Nellis Air Force Base in Las Vegas, the same thing, because that's what I like to do and what I had been doing. So they sent me to Valdosta, Georgia, as an instrument instructor and also academic instructor, diametrically opposed to what I wanted to do and where I wanted to go. And I began to dawned in on me that the Air Force didn't have my best interests at heart. But anyway, it was good, actually. The experience was good. I learned a lot more about instrument flying than I had known previously going through normal flight training.
So
then I got into the 94C down there, too, which is all-weather interceptor training school then. Lockheed F-94C, that was one of the first airplanes with an afterburner. That was a beautiful airplane. So I got involved in instructing in that, as well as...
So that was an Air Defense Command
the Air Defense Command, I guess.
Yeah, T-Bird with a... What? See, Frank Murray flew it. What did he call it? He said it was something about it. The heck, they had radar and an afterburner. He had a funny expression. I think he said it had a heater and TV, I think is what he said.
Yeah, it did, yeah. Yeah,
heater and TV.
Sounds like Frank. Yeah. Yeah, it did. It was first one of the very first airplanes with an afterburner. Oh. It was a glorified T-33 or F-80. It had a 24 rockets, 2.75-inch rockets, pods on each wing. And you could salvo all of them, and you did feel that slow down.
And you ran a beam attack on that one, didn't you? Isn't that what the idea is? You can run a beam attack, and at a certain range, the radar would tell the rockets when to fire and all that? Or was that, I know the F-86 D, that's what it did.
Did it?
Yeah, you know, because it had that big pod that dropped down underneath it with a bunch of rockets, and I guess it was pretty accurate, apparently. You know, put enough junk out there, you hit something.
Yeah.
we got to fire it at targets, and it was pretty impressive, especially if they salvaged all of them. That airplane was it was reported to have been able to go supersonic. And Tony LeVere, who was the Lockheed legendary test pilot that flew first flight on some of these great airplanes, going back to the P-38. Anyway, he said he demonstrated, or he did go supersonic in it, but the technique had to be followed closely. And the way to do it was 40,000 feet, max burner, and fast as it would go, and then push over, nose down to, felt like vertical, about a 60-degree dive angle, full afterburner, and about 30,000 feet, you would allegedly go Mach 1.001 or something like that.
Wow. Did it have
it was quite a maneuver.
And did it have a Mach meter? Could you actually see the Mach?
No, just airspeed.
But I talked to an old Navy F-8 pilot. He said it could go supersonic. And I said, well, you know, you didn't have anything that would indicate that. He said, well, that's what the tech rep told me.
Yeah. Well, in this one, the airplane had a variable elevator ratio of normal level flight cruise, was maybe 2.5 or something on the ratio, 2.5 to 1. But it'd go all the way up, it was adjustable, all the way up to 11 to 1 elevator ratio. And you had to remember to move that up to 11 to 1 ratio before you got into this thing. You could have a hell of a time getting out. And of course, it was straight wing, not built for supersonic. And went through all kinds of weird things getting out there. You have aileron buzz, and you have nose tuck, and you had a rudder, a differential rudder shock wave dissipation, so the rudder would have full pressure on one side and then lose pressure on the other, and the rudder would go bang, full over, and kick your feet off the pedals.
It was crazy. So you tried it, in other words?
Oh, a lot of times. Yeah, we'd give dollar rides to people in the back and
tell them they went supersonic.
Yeah. If you did that and started pulling out at 30,000, and you get level at maybe 20. But our friends in the F-89 squadron, it wouldn't do that at all. But a couple of guys tried it, instructors, and they dug huge holes into the Okefenokee Swamp.
Oh, geez.
Which was the what Moody and Valdosta, Georgia are known for is the Okie Finokie Swamp.
Yeah.
Right on the edge of the swamp. But anyway, it was interesting airplane. It was fun. And
there was a two-seater, and so the guy in the back was running the radar, I guess.
Right, a radar.
And so we were actually involved in an active ADC squadron at that time?
No, just at the interceptor training school.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
So you were training?
They had F-89Ds, and then they had F-84Cs, so they were the two interceptors. And luckily, I didn't have to get involved with the F-89.
Yeah.
Talk about a lead sled, boy. I got out in December of 55. My mother passed away in May. And I had these two younger brothers who were badly in need of adult supervision.
So then you went back to L.A.?
No.
When you got out?
Oh, when I got out?
Yeah.
The 94 program was good for me at Moody because they were Lockheed airplanes. And they had to go back to Lockheed Aircraft Services in Ontario for major overhaul. And quite often I'd be able to take a ferry one of them back to Ontario, California, and met a lot of Lockheed people there. And I had a second cousin who worked for Lockheed, and he was with Kelly Johnson in the Skunk Works when they first started the Skunk Works.
When was that?
It was in 1940, early 40s.
Oh, it went back all that far, huh?
Yeah, the P-80 was developed by the Skunk Works, and it was 143 days from a contract to the first flight of the airplane. It was amazing. 143 days.
That is amazing.
Just showed what somebody like Kelly, absolute genius, design genius, as well as a managerial genius. He knew how to get things done. And if he had his, you know, didn't have excess oversight by the government, he could really, really do. He did the job beautifully on all of those early airplanes, P-38, the P-80, then later on the F-104, U-2, of course. But anyway, I did meet a lot of people on these trips back and forth from Moody to Ontario. And my second cousin, who was very close to, actually in the Skunk Works and close to Kelly, he was Kelly's number one flight test maintenance guy, in charge of their flight test maintenance.
What was his name?
Dorsey Kammerer. He's quite a character. He was kind of legendary in himself. Anyway, he got on one of the trips, he took me over to Burbank and introduced me to Tony Levere, who was the chief test pilot for the Skunk Works.
Is he, where did he live? Is he still around, or he's probably long
no,
since?
No, he passed away, God,
long
must have been 15, 20 years ago. But he was instrumental in helping me get into Lockheed.
So you had a little bit of a door in?
I did. I had that connection, but I couldn't get into flight operations when I got out of the Air Force and went to work for Lockheed, so I didn't have enough flight time. I didn't meet the 1,500-hour minimum time they had as a requirement to join the flight operations.
So they had some sort of a program for test pilots then?
No, they put me in. They made me a flight manuals engineer, which is actually part of the flight test division. And in the meantime, I talked to a good friend of mine into going partners with me on a Cessna 170 to build up time. And actually, it's kind of ironic, they didn't care what kind of airplane you had, you got your time in. You know, I could have gotten 1,500 hours easily if I had flown big, you know, C-54s or whatever. But flying fighters, I didn't get much time. I only
right.
had 1,100 hours. Anyway, I get this buddy of mine, who wasn't even a pilot, went into partnership with me on a Cessna 170. And flew the heck out of that. But In the meantime, they're building up on the 104 program, and they still have the T-33 going, and they were getting kind of desperate because of this rapid buildup on the F-104. It had just flown first flight in 1954, and right in the middle of the flight test program on the 104.
So was it secretly developed as a black?
No, it wasn't secret. It wasn't like the U-2.
Yeah. But they were developed about the same time, weren't they?
Yeah, first flight was about pretty close to the same time. I think the U-2 was...
So when was your first flight in the F-104? They must have had some sort of preliminary thing to fly before you flew the 104.
Yeah,
yeah. You don't go 170 to 104, right?
Yeah, right. I started out as a flight manuals engineer in Burbank, and it was right when they were developing the first F-104 flight handbook for the Air Force, and I was assigned to that, and also to rewrite the F-94C handbook, because I knew so much about that. That's what I was doing at Moody, was teaching academics as well as flying it. Anyway, long story, but I did get to learn a whole lot about the 104 during that 1 year period. I kept bugging flight operations and Tony, and finally they got desperate and they said, okay, Weaver, go to Palmdale and quit bothering us.
So they flew it out of Edwards then?
No, they were all of the production and flight test, Lockheed flight test, was at Palmdale on the 104.
Okay. What was your first flight in 104?
April of 57. I went up there in December of 56.
Was it a single-seater or two-seater?
The one I checked out in was the XF-104, and that was a single.
So you flew it right from the very beginning then?
Yeah. But what hit the 104s, the XF, two prototypes they built, had been flying since 55. That was the... don't drop anything.
But, behind us.
Yeah.
Let me get this a little closer.
Yeah.
Tell us about your first flight in the 104 after coming from something less powerful.
It was impressive. And even though the XF-104 was didn't have the J-79 that the 104 was designed to have.
Right.
It wasn't ready when the XF was, the prototype was built. They had a J-65 Westinghouse with only 10,000 pounds of thrust max, but it didn't weigh a whole lot more than that.
Yeah.
It was about, I think, 13,000 pounds max. They, and no simulator or anything, no, not much ground school. In those days, you know, they'd give you a handbook and checklists and stuff. But I got in it and had it explained to me, and real nice, easy airplane to fly, except the performance was pretty impressive. Roaring down that runway so damn fast. When I checked out in the P-80, had a solo in that after flying T-6, I was really impressed with that takeoff too. So quiet, and you'd hear the asphalt, whatever they call them on the runway, click, click, click.
The expansion joints.
Expansion joints. But this damn XF-104, not even the 104A, it was click, 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 click. Wow, what's going on? So, anyway, I went up, flew it for not very much range on that XF, about a 45-minute flight to an hour flight. But I started catching up with it on final approach. I think I was almost with it on landing. Made a pretty good landing.
Did you go supersonic the first time?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Went fast. And I remember comparing that with going supersonic.
Straight down.
Straight down.
all the controls rattling around. This is so smooth. Didn't know you were supersonic except for the Mach meter.
How many 104s did they make?
Well, the Air Force version, it was the A and the B and the C and the D. A was the interceptor version. It went to Air Defense Command. A model of the 104 was an interceptor. The B model was the trainer for that version.
And it had a gun too, doesn't it? The 104 had a gun?
It had a Gatling
gun. Gatling gun, right. Yeah.
20 millimeter.
So is that, when you do the testing, did you test all those things that they would do, fire missiles and all that stuff? Was that part of the testing, or was it just to provide the airframe to give to the Air Force?
Well, I was, when I went to Palmdale as a test pilot, it was a production test, not experimental or engineering. And in that capacity, you have to go through every new airplane, every airplane off the production line. You just check out everything on a first production flight. Just go through every system, and then we did even fire the guns to evaluate for radar sparking when the guns were fired. That's what they are, radar. The term they used was radar sparking. We had to go up to Mach, firing the guns. We did, let's see, I'm getting my systems mixed up. The radar sparking was an issue with loss of pressure by doing a zoom up to max altitude of the regular airplane, not the augmented.
Not the NF.
But, well, actually just the regular airplane, when they set the world speed and altitude record, they were doing it in a standard, an A model.
How fast did it go?
I think it was 1,500 and some miles an hour. Wow. And got up to 80 some thousand feet.
It got to 80,000 feet?
Yeah. I think that was it.
Wow.
Maybe it was more than that. I've got it somewhere in a book.
So did you do that, or was that?
We had to do the on some airplanes every, I don't know, they picked like one out of every 10 or 20. You'd do this zoom maneuver to check for radar arcing at when the pressure was decreased at a zoom, on a zoom climb up to whatever altitude it went. And you could get up to about 70,000 in those, on those maneuvers. You get up to Mach 2 and basically full burn, of course, and about 63,000 going up, the burner would blow out. And then you just keep on going, and it got an easy nose over and up about 73,000.
So we were wearing a pressure suit?
Yeah, a partial pressure suit.
Wow.
Which were uncomfortable, but they served a purpose.
That was in the 104?
In the 104, yeah.
So you were the production test pilot as opposed to
start with, yeah.
So of the 3,000 or 4,000 or whatever made, you flew a bunch of them, I guess.
Well, yeah, I flew a bunch of 104s. Then I flew that in production test as well as T-33 and also T-2V. It was a Navy version of the T-33.
Right.
Those were the three airplanes I was flying there in production test.
So your job basically was to go to work in the morning. You probably lived up in Palmdale at the time.
I lived actually to begin with.
But so those were the three airplanes you flew there. Yeah. Did you ever fly the U-2?
Never did, no.
But you knew about it, of course.
Yeah.
And now comes up to, you're flying it from, say, 56 to 58, 59, something like that?
Yeah, I was flying, doing that and got involved with the, after the 104As and 104AB and CD were U.S. Air Force airplanes. The A was the interceptor, and then the C was the, had, well, luckily they had better engines. We had so many problems in those early 104 days with it. It was a brand new airplane, brand new engine, and the engine was not reliable at all.
Why did the Germans have so much trouble with it?
It was mainly lack of experience.
I thought part of it was the materials themselves, too. They didn't have high-quality steel or whatever they were using. You know what I mean?
The German weather, I'm sure, didn't help.
It was, I think, the main cause of their accident, high accident rate, was lack of experience, because after the war, they completely demilitarized Germany.
But most of those guys, when I was in Germany, after pilot training, Maury went west, I went east, and they had mostly old Luftwaffe pilots. They had a lot of highly experienced pilots, and the same way with the Italians, they had a lot of World War II Fiat, whatever things they were flying down there.
What year was that?
66 through 68.
66, yeah. Yeah, by that time they did. But this was, you know, the Germans got their first airplanes in 61. And they got the advanced model, the F-104G.
So what year was it that they had those big, huge boxes come up to Palmdale with the A-12s inside?
That was just before the first flight. Yeah,
Had you seen the airplane before? Obviously you had.
I hadn't, no.
No, really?
I didn't see the airplane until I got on the program, which was in 1964. And the first flight of the A-12 was April of 62. And they were shipped up from Burbank these big boxes.
Yeah, yeah, but how did you not see them?
Well, they weren't, unless you could go to Area 51, you couldn't see them until they got to Edwards.
Did you know about it?
We did, once Lyndon Johnson announced the speed records by these super secret new airplanes.
Yeah, the A-11, he called it.
A-11. Yeah. Well, that's nice.
Who's that? Lawrence
Goldman. What if he can pick that up?
Thanks.
That's an unusual road down there, isn't it?
That's a service road, yeah. Oh.
So he announces as a reconnaissance airplane, the A-11. And so, you've been flying the 104 TV2 for quite a few years.
The 104 program. I think the last T-33, over 6,000 T-33s were built. P-80s, or F-80s, or T-33s, over 6,000. The first one came off the line, I've forgotten, at about 1962, something like that. Tony LeVere flew the first and the last flight on that. And then after that, it was just mostly 104s. Then I got involved in training the German guys, the first cadre of German pilots, who were going to go back and be their instructors when they got the 104s.
So you have a lot of time in the 104.
I had a lot of time. I was still flying it intermittently until 1973. So I flew it.
Well, they used it for the chase for the.
Used it for the chase for the Blackbirds, and then the Air Force had a huge 104 training program going on at Luke Air Force Base, and then getting back to why they had such a high accident rate. Back then, when they got the airplanes, they got the first airplanes were, operational squadron was organized in 1961, and we had trained their first group of pilots who were going to be instructors for that initial squadron. We trained them at Palmdale in 1960, I think. We had an interim 104 version for the Germans called the 104F, and it didn't have any of the fancy radar systems or anything like that, air fire control. But the guys they sent over, six pilots, four of them were the young lieutenants who had an average time of 400 hours.
Wow.
400 hours. And the other two were World War II guys. One was a lieutenant colonel, the other was a captain in the Luftwaffe. Lieutenant colonel was something else. Gunter Rau was his name. He's a number three.
Gunter Rau.
Gunter.
360 victories.
275 victories.
275? I know it's a lot.
And what a character. He was a great guy, really good pilot. He had a little problem in 104, flying formation too, because the speed brake, little speed brake switches on the top of the throttle, and this thumb was shut off. He was shot down eight times. And so he'd had to go like that to manipulate the speed brakes.
Have you ever seen a conversation between him and a guy named Shorty? Who actually, he thought that was the guy that shot his thumb off.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
I haven't seen that.
Yeah, it was probably 10 years ago. It's on the internet. The guy was, a P-47 pilot. And he got in a huge dogfight. Oh, there was another German. Who was it? Maybe I like Gunter Rau. He got shot three times before lunch.
Yeah, they get shut down, find another airplane, get shut down again. I think that
just
happened.
Just coming out of the parachute the last time, he's going, I've been shot down three times since I have a lunchtime yet.
Yeah, though they were something. And he became, later, Gunter became the chief of staff of the Luftwaffe and also then was a leading general in NATO.
Yeah.
Wow. Terrific guy.
I've seen interviews with him. He's really an interesting guy. Yeah,
he came over here several times. You know, we had him here once. Good guy. A lot of fun. And he very energetic and so sharp. He lived in Bavaria, had a beautiful place in the Bavarian Alps.
Oh yeah.
Avid skier and very active. He came down with a heart issue, congestive heart issue or something. He drove himself to the hospital when he passed away. Drove himself to the hospital, checked in, and then a couple of days later. He was gone.
Wow.
Too bad. Yeah.
Let's go. Let's move on to the Blackbirds. Okay, so the first time you saw
was when I went to Area 51.
And so the Oxcart program had started in obvious, tremendously dark secret airplanes built in Burbank.
That's right. Yeah. I had to three of our guys from the Lockheed flight test, guys from Palmdale, had disappeared from Palmdale and wondered where they went.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And we finally realized that they went to the dark side, something was going on, and we didn't know anything about it, and we weren't supposed to. And I knew the three guys real well. And we had a dinner party one night at one of the guys' houses, and they talked to me about the program and thought I might be interested in getting on it. And so I said, well, what do you do? We can't tell you, but you'd be very impressed with it. And anyway, I was lucky to get on it. They were building up mainly for the SR program, because that was when the SR was first. The first airplane was the A-12, flew in April of 62, and then the YF-12 was 63, I can't remember when, in 63.
So when was your first flight in the A-12?
A-12 was January of, it took me about 4 or 5 months to get a top secret clearance to get on the program. And then I got that. I think December, it came through in December, and January I went up there and checked out.
And that was your the first look at one?
First look at one was when I went up there and then checked out.
And well, what was your impression?
Well, I flew the 104 Chase airplane.
Yeah.
That was the very first. And then I got checked out and they had a trainer.
Well, that must have been a real gee whiz moment, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, the first one just went subsonic, and that wasn't that impressive.
But just to look at it, I mean, it's...
Oh, to look at it, oh, my God, yeah. That was really impressive.
Now, and Frank Murray said he answered an ad that they needed NASA, I think it was said they needed NASA chase pilots, and he was being transferred from the East Coast to Alaska in F-102s or F-101s, and they found out he had F-101 experience, and so he said... So he came out to Nevada and interviewed, and he didn't know what the heck he was going to be doing. And then to see the airplane was like, Jesus, you know. So now you're basically a CIA guy, sort of.
Yeah, well, it was still Lockheed, but I was up there where the CIA guys were, and flying the CIA airplane. Yeah, my first flight, like I said, was subsonic in the trainer. And that had two flights in that, and that was mainly to just kind of get the feel of that. It wasn't nearly as impressive performance-wise. It had two J-75 engines instead of the two J-58s.
Was there did they have a two-seat trainer for the A-12?
Yeah, two-seat with an elevated half cockpit, just like the...
It's out by USC... by the museum over there.
Yeah.
The titanium goose.
They call it the titanium goose. Yeah.
Yeah, that's what the one that's on display that's looks silvery. Everybody goes by and they wonder why they call the airplane the Blackbird.
Yeah, I know. That's right.
Well, the first A-12 to fly was silver, wasn't it?
Yeah, all the first ones were. Right. But then
off.
We did.
What? I it went off.
Did you knew Ray Haupt, didn't you?
Yeah.
Well, he was my instructor in the Titanium Goose.
Oh, okay.
And we did in-flight refueling and just basic flying around, a couple flights in-flight refueling, and then after that, I got my first ride in the A model subsonic. But I've been flying the 104 so much. Up there, I flew the 104 Chase too, several times. So I'm not all that impressed with the initial takeoff.
Right.
And then flying subsonically was beautiful. Flew so smooth and responsive and stable.
Right.
And then I got my first. I think I just had one subsonic, and then I supersonic out to Mach 3. Fly up the Canadian border and back and around, had a regular route from Area 51. And that was pretty impressive. And out of the Air Force 104s. Lockheed only built 293 104s for the Air Force.
Wow.
But after the consortium European program and foreign programs, we ended up selling 2,500 F-104s to 14 different countries. A lot of them were actually, most of them were under license for the consortium. Was Messerschmitt in Germany, Fokker in Holland, Fiat in Italy.
So those they were being made in different places.
And they were manufactured, different components manufactured in these various, the four consortium facilities. And then they'd send parts around and assemble the final version and fly it out of each of the. Messerschmitt was the lead, and that's where I was assigned to that program for 7 months over at Messerschmitt in 61 and 62.
What town?
The town of Messerschmitt's facility was in Manching, Germany, but it was only about 45 miles from Munich, which is great. Munich, my first experience in Germany was arriving in Munich to go on that program. Oh, wow. I didn't want to leave Munich. Munching and Ingolstadt, two little villages right together.
Yeah, yeah.
Where, but that was quite an experience.
So now you, so your first, I, maybe I ask you, what was what, the, your first flight in the A-12 was when? Okay, and now, so were you testing them as they were coming
off? No, I'm sorry, 64.
64.
Because I went up there December 22nd of 64 was the first flight date of the SR. And I think that was the date I first went up there to the area, December of 64. But I,
so you were flying the A-12 or the, when, the S, when the SR was being announced then? No, wait.
No, the SR flew December 22nd, 64. And that's my first trip up to the area.
Okay.
Was,
so they're announcing the SR when you're going to be flying the A-12.
Well, they'd already announced it.
What, the previous year, yeah.
Yeah.
Except no pictures and no information about it at
all. Yeah, right. And then they... Well, then
it's really interesting. They ran parallel programs. One completely CIA, one's Air Force. It's just really odd that they did it that way.
Well, I'm glad the CIA had the first project because they knew Kelly could build airplanes and get them done, to get the job done on time and on budget, and he and without any interference, he could do magic, you know, magic things.
So with the A-12, I think we have the last A-12 in San Diego, number 933. I think that's the last one, because when I read the YF-12, it looks like 934, 35, and 36 are the YFs. And so then did the SR-71 come after the YFs?
Yes, YF first flew in 63. I've got all that stuff written down, so in one of the books, one of the many books. But
so what was the best one to fly?
They were all real similar characteristics. Everything about them was similar. The A-12 was lighter and could actually go higher than the SR.
What was the highest you ever got into?
I got about 88, somewhere around there.
Yeah, it says in the thing, I found an article here, apparently it was secret at one time, about 1967, a comparison to SR-71 and the A-12.
That was a good, yeah, I got that. Yeah, that data is very interesting.
Yeah, it shows we'll go to like 92,000 feet.
Yeah.
Probably just as you flame out.
Yeah.
3,500 nautical mile range, wow. So the, so now you flew the A-12 for a while, but...
Yeah, I had probably by the time they got me to mainly to be with the SR and to be like a production test, do all the production tests on the SR because of my past experience as production test pilot.
Okay.
So on the SR... flight test. I was also doing engineering flight test as well as production. So I flew all the production flights out of Palmdale and then the engineering flights out of Edwards.
What do you mean by an engineering flight?
It's experimental. It's a more technical term, you know, than I guess. I don't know.
So how many times do you actually think you flew an A-12?
I had 10 flights in it. And then after that, it was then when the A-12 became operational. That was 67, I think. They were only operational for a year, and then you guys took it over.
Yeah.
Well, actually, it was parallel at the same time.
Yeah.
For a
they
while.
Flew out Okinawa for like 6 months together.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then they started arguing about who had the best missions and all
right,
that.
Right.
It was, you know, when talking to Frank Murray, it was amazing. He flew it for a long time before it ever did anything operationally. It's just
they flew it for years. Because I would look, I flew it in 65, my first flight, January or February. and then they kept flying it up there at the area, but didn't become operational until 67. And we're only operational for a year.
Did you ever fly any missions to test the radar effectiveness of it? I have a follow-up question to that. I mean, so in other words, against other airplanes.
No, I never flew the YF-12. I flew it, but that was late in the program.
So moving from the A-12 to the YF.
YF was last. I flew the SR and started that in March of... started on the SR in March of 65. The first ones were coming out. Production. I was in 2003.
I thought the YF was kind of in between the two.
It was. But, I mean, my experience on the YF was after the SR.
It says your first flight of the YF is 7 August 63.
Yeah. That was first flight of the YF. Jim Eastham flew that. First flight of the YF was, 67, I think.
How was the YF different? What did it do differently?
Well, it was an interceptor, designed to be an interceptor, and it had a radome, fire control radome. You can look at the configuration and see it's different. It shines on the YF-12, just came to an abrupt stop, and then the forward section of the nose was the radome, really.
It's a round nose in the front.
Yeah.
You can see it there.
You can see it there. Right.
By the way, I'm going to add pictures to this,
video. Yeah, and it had ventral fins, fixed fins.
Right.
As well as a retractable ventral on the center line.
What was that for? Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's what that thing that hung down was.
Yeah, with the gear down, but this retractable, the retractable ventral fin was pretty big. On the ground, it had to be retracted, or it would scrape the ground. It was that big, and that was to provide increased lateral stability, because with the shorter chine configuration, it affects lift and stability, and that the missile is on a retractable platform. They lower that and fire the missile, and in that configuration, directional stability was affected also. So they had the two permanent verticals on the ailerons below those, and then they had the retractable. And my one experience in the YF-12 was landing at Edwards with the retractable gear, and to put the gear down, this thing retracts. This thing didn't retract. So I landed, had to land, red light on, and I couldn't do anything about it. And touched down, and it was pretty smooth. I just couldn't even detect anything really wrong with it. Kind of a little thump when I touched down. And just ground off about a few inches of that titanium fin, I guess.
It stopped a little faster, I suppose.
Yeah, right.
So when the Skunk Works designed the YF, that was probably a secret project too.
It was secret, but it was Air Force.
But made to do intercepts of bombers that far out to sea or whatever.
Yeah, and the Air Force really liked it, but the Department of Defense had McNamara at that time, and he didn't like it, and he said it's a waste of money. What is the reason for that? Here you are at 75,000 feet in Mach 3. What's going to be up there that you're going to shoot down with this fancy missile? And what are you going to do? You can't do anything. You can't find a target at any lower level or much lower level where it would be effective. So they did a demonstration with the YF-12 up at out of Eglin, shooting down a B-47 drone, which was 1,500 feet above the water and 125 miles away,
there's the, our, the Air Force guys were flying 125 miles away, 75,000, and he a direct hit on that P-47 down on the deck almost. It was amazing. And oh boy, the Air Force, they were chomping at the bit to get that, but McNamara canceled it.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So
we only build three of them.
So, but I understood the YF-12 was a A-12 that had been extended to put in a second cockpit, but it sounds more like it was almost contiguous with the SR-71 program being built, that is.
Well, it was... I don't know, it had to be. Yeah.
So how come you flew it, the YF-12?
They had a project going at Eglin involving all weather stuff, and so I guess I don't know where Easton was, but he was the principal pilot on it.
Yeah.
Easton, and anyway, they wanted me to go down there. I was down there for about a couple of weeks.
So now you said before that
I did fly it at Edwards a few times.
They said Bob Gilliland was the head test pilot for the
SR.
And that was one reason why it had a pretty big cockpit. He's a big guy.
No, that wasn't the reason, but yeah. It's a nice cockpit, but it wasn't the reason.
Well, so you flew the SR, you flew the YF, and then you flew the SR?
Yeah, I flew the SR first.
Okay.
Then the YF. Okay. And that was near the end of the YF program.
So you were kind of the production test pilot for the SR then?
Yeah. Yeah, I flew, like, I think 22 first flights of the SRs.
Really? But they didn't make many more than that.
Made 32.
All right.
Well, one was a hybrid.
So that's the A-12C?
A-12C
or something like they call it.
Yeah.
It was the C model, yeah.
C model, right.
Yeah, yeah.
And they built two B models.
Yeah, Lockheed built two B models. I flew the first one with Bob Killen and I on the first one with that.
And then I thought Tom Pugh jumped out of the second B model or something off of BO. They had a complete electrical failure or something. And
yeah.
The fuel pumps starved the engine and they bailed out.
Yep.
Well, speaking of bailouts, I may as well talk about...
Oh, yeah.
A miracle that happened sometime in 1966.
Yeah.
So you were flying with an SR. You were flying an SR.
SR-71. It was. They had four test pilot test bed airplanes for flight test SRs up at Edwards, and I was assigned to this one. 2003, which is number four airplane. And this was a routine test flight from Edwards on January, one of the J months, January 25th, 1966. And the objective of the flight was number one objective was to look at, evaluate the sensors. We had a reconnaissance system specialist, a guy named Jim Zwer, retired lieutenant colonel from the Air Force. He was in the B-58 program for the Air Force. Good guy and really experienced, really expert in that field. So Lockheed hired him for this program. He was in the back seat, and like I said, the objectives were to evaluate the sensor systems, the side-looking camera, and all that stuff. And then also to evaluate a procedure to try and enhance performance and range of the airplane by reducing trim drag at high Mach. Trim drag can... the more forward the center of gravity, the more trim drag you have because it requires aileron, nose up aileron. to counteract the Mach effect on pitch attitude. So the way we're going to do that is move the center of gravity back, just beyond the aft limit. Not much, but when you move it further aft the seat, center of gravity goes, the more reduced the longitudinal stability of the airplane. So that's why you don't want to get too far back. But you say, well, we just not too far, but maybe 1%, something like that. And we took off and flew on a pre-planned profile out to Texas, Dalhart, Texas, and a hot leg is one where you go out to Mach 3.2. We went out, everything was okay, and came back and hit a tanker and refueled and repeated basically the same pattern. And we got up on the second leg and just got up to cruise speed, Mach 3.2, 3.18, something like that, and 75, 76,000 feet, and started a turn, a program turn, autopilot on, basically 180 degree turn to go back toward Edwards on the mission profile. But prior to that, as we're accelerating, got up 2.8, 3.0, somewhere around there, notice, had an issue with the inlet control system on the right side. Finally had to go to manual control. And it was, we'd gotten to the point where we had yawing intermittently. And anyhow, we got into this turn and I opened up the forward bypass doors to give us a little better inlet unstart margin. Unfortunately, that wasn't enough when you consider all of the other conditions. So we were about, maybe 30 degrees through the turn, 35 degree bank, autopilot, and all of a sudden, an unstart. I forget to mention unstarts, but these were very, this where the engine inlet system, the inlet control system is very complex, and its purpose is to position the shockwave, basically the shockwave of the supersonic air coming into the inlet, into an optimum position where it becomes subsonic. The Mach 3 air gets down to subsonic before it hits the engine face, the engine compressor face inlet. And the purpose is for that to provide optimum performance of the engine. And if it is too far forward, performance is degraded. Gets too far aft, it can result in what they call an unstart. And that's when that shockwave is violently expelled and accompanied by tremendous oscillation, vibration, shake, sounds like a nuclear explosion. Some guys like to compare it with a train wreck. It's like being in a train wreck. I never was in a train wreck, but I could take their word for it. And it's in those early days, it was a very common occurrence. And you get used to it.
Well, it was common for you too, Maury. Didn't you have it happen a bunch?
Yeah, it was still relatively common when the first time I was in the program. The second time when I was in, I had two tours, 73 to 78, and then 81 to 84. Yeah, and that's when they had the DAFIX came on board.
When the DAFIX came on board, yeah.
And it reduced a lot of the unstarts.
Well, didn't you have one flight where it continued to unstart?
Had loaded they had put in the wrong schedule on the inlets. It was a flight out of Okinawa. It was actually an operational sortie, and I was still flying with Don Bullock at that time. And we took off, and We got up around 2.3 or 4, and it started a unstart. I couldn't get it to go any faster, and I tried to go manual, and it seemed like it was running okay manual, but then Don, as I recall, said, we'll never complete the mission if we try to fly it in manual. So we made one more try in auto, and it kept on starting, and I think we had about 5 or 6 unstarts. And I mean, it was just beating the heck out of us. Yeah. I was always gung-ho. I'm going to go on this mission. I'm going to go till, you know.
Yeah,
and,
right.
And so when we came back and we told them what happened in debrief, they were sitting there, and I think Tom Estes was still the commander then. And he's just shaking his head. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, well, we had a little bet going, you know, with the avionics, you know, who programmed the schedule. Because they realized they put in the wrong schedule, and they said, should we recall him? And I asked him what's going to happen. He said, he'll get a couple unstarts. It won't run right. And they said, well, he'll just turn around and come back. And the bet was how many unstarts till he comes back, till he gives up. So Colonel Estes said, I lost. And that's why he said, I'm shaking my head. Oh, I didn't think you were that stupid.
Well, so let me ask you a question for a second. You have the doors and you have the spike. And you had doors in front and doors in back.
Yeah, correct. Forward and back.
Forward and aft.
And aft.
And the idea with the doors is it's going to expel air out over those or go into the bypass. And what went into the bypass and went to the out to the doors that expelled the air?
Well, I thought it was, isn't it the aft doors that take it through the nacelle and dump it into the afterburner?
Into the afterburner, yeah.
And the forward doors just dumped it overboard, didn't it? Just come straight up.
Yeah.
If you look on the top of the nacelle, there's a bunch of little, like this lattice work, and the door slides open, you know, it's rotating, it's a circle. It rotates open, and air just goes...
But those big ducts come off the... looks like they
the
come
engine.
Off, yeah, up the front.
Right. Well, the two doors, when it says at forward and aft, the aft is very close to the forward. It's not all the way in the back.
And
but it's behind the forward door, so they called it the aft door. Yeah, that's sort of misleading.
So here we are. We're talking about the e-ticket ride that you experienced.
Yeah.
So you get an unstart.
It was just, you know, I'd had a lot of unstarts, but nothing like this.
How fast were you going?
3.18 Mach.
And how high?
78,800. I remember those numbers.
Wow.
78,800, 3.18.
So what'd you do?
Well, I pushed the stick as far forward as I could because it was going increased like...
You were in a 30, turn, right?
I was in a 35-degree bank turn. It went up to 60 like that, at least 60, and the nose pitched up like that. And I went full forward and full left and nothing. I knew we've had it. I'm going to pitch up, obviously, couldn't stop it.
Did you ever hit pitch up before?
Never, no.
So it pitches up and then you push the stick forward and then?
Then nothing happened. I mean, it completely, and then I blacked out. But when it started within, I don't know, maybe immediately it was 60 degrees and going up. And I said, oh shit, this is going to pitch up. And I've tried to tell Jim, I didn't think we could eject safely at Mach 3.18 and 78,000 feet. And my thought was, stay with whatever's left of this until we get down to lower speed and altitude, and then eject. Well, by that time, I was up to 5-10 Gs already, and my voice, they've recovered the voice recorder, and everything I could say was trying to say something, but it gurgled and garbled and nothing. Nothing that Jim could ever react to anyway, neither one of us. Fell full forward, and I blacked out, and the last thing I remember when I was conscious was I was here and the airplane was here going up at a rapid rate. So then the next thing I now recall was I thought I was having a nightmare, and God, I said, that was a terrible dream. I sure hope I wake up and get out of that dream. And then I became more conscious, and I thought, that wasn't a dream. It really happened. So I must be dead. I couldn't have survived that. And I felt okay. Gee, what's everybody worried about, being dead and all that bad? I felt kind of euphoric. Not so bad. And then I fully regained consciousness, and I could feel myself, but I was no airplane. I was just, I could feel myself kind of falling, and I was free of the airplane, and here I heard like wind rushing, and but I couldn't see anything because my faceplate had iced over complete. I couldn't see a thing. Had no idea where I was, how I got there, where the airplane was. And I was worried about all this automatic stuff. The ejection system has that capability, but I figured I didn't eject, and so is that automatic stuff going to work? And I was really worried then at that high altitude about, you know, high rotational forces. If the body starts to rotate or tumble, there's nothing, no air pressure to stop it. It can get up to very high centrifugal speeds and physical damage. That's happened to a lot of guys. And
that's what happened to the guy in the X-15, wasn't it? They got sideways coming down. And
yeah, I think so, yeah.
Probably.
So anyway, I was worried about that, but I was falling. Pretty stable position, kind of vertical and kind of rotating, but not any high rate of anything, just nice and smooth. And I could hear the rushing noise, air rushing noise, and I also thought I could hear noise like some straps flapping in the breeze, and I couldn't figure out what that would be. I was wondering about the parachute opening automatically at 15,000 feet. An Android device automatically opens the main parachute. So I started thinking about all these things and wondering how long I'd free-falled and just how high I was. But I couldn't see, and I was kind of afraid to lift the faceplate if I was too high and needed that oxygen. But I finally said, well, I got to do that. And I took a deep breath and started to unlatch the faceplate. All of a sudden, I felt the main chute open. It was a great feeling that was. So I knew I had to be 15,000 or below. And then I opened the faceplate so I could see. And one of the first things I saw was Jim's parachute. Hard to estimate, but I'd say half mile away. Yeah, boy, I was so happy because I didn't think either one of us could survive, and to realize that now that both of us had was a tremendous feeling. And then I started looking around for where we're going to land and what the terrain looks like. And I wasn't sure which state we were over when this happened, because we were right at that Four Corners area of Texas, New Mexico, Oklahoma, Colorado. They all kind of meet. Well, we could be over, but I wasn't worried about that anyway. I was also really worried about the terrain, and the terrain didn't look very promising at all. It was looked like high plateau country, and no sign of habitation anywhere. Really in the boonies with patches of snow. January and a cold front had just moved through. So I thought to myself, well, we're going to have to spend the night here, as it was like mid-afternoon there, their time, whoever's time it was. Anyway, I couldn't remember what was in it. We have an escape kit, emergency kit attached to a chute harness, and I was trying to remember what was in that. I'm trying to remember what they taught me in survival training about making a tent out of a parachute. All that stuff was going through my mind. And so, anyway, and the main problem was I was coming down facing one direction, and I couldn't turn my chute around because I had to hold the faceplate up to see. And then pull on the risers. I could only pull on one riser, and not real well at that. So I was coming down mostly in one direction, northwest, and I sure didn't like what I saw. So I got closer to the ground. I released that escape kit, as an emergency kit, was in attached to a lanyard. So you pull the lanyard and release the contents of that before you touch down, because if you touch down with that big kit, you can bust your knees or something. So I did that. I pulled on that and saw the contents falling down on this lanyard, and looked down, and there's a big, huge animal jumped up right where I was going to land. I found out later on it was an antelope. That was antelope country. But he was more scared than I was. He was roaring off in a cloud of dust. And then I touched down. I'd never done that before. And touched down smoothly. With nice, smooth terrain. And I kind of rolled over on my back and picked myself up. And I didn't feel bad at all. I didn't have no aches and pains, nothing. Oh, geez. Pressure suits pretty darn good. It's, you know, not only does the stuff the real requirements that you're aware of, which are breathing oxygen and pressurizing the suit to prevent the blood from boiling and those things, but also it's like when it's pressurized like that, it's like you're in your own little capsule, you know. Found out later I had a little whiplash in my neck, but nothing serious. And I had a couple of bruises and scratch on my nose where that lip mic, I guess, kind of cut it. That was it. So then I picked myself up, and it's pretty cumbersome with holding the faceplate up and trying to get up and collapse the chute, because the parachute was billowing in the wind. And flying out of Edwards and Palmdale, you're very aware of the high winds and ejecting, because there are always high winds up there. But it was billowing, and I didn't want to get dragged. So I'm standing up there, holding this up, pulling on the riser, to try and collapse it. And I thought I heard something that sounded like a helicopter. And I'm hallucinating again. And then I heard a voice. And, God, what's going on here? And the voice got louder. And I said, some guy's saying, "Can I help you? Can I help you?" And I looked up, and here's a guy with a cowboy hat walking toward me, and behind him is a helicopter with a rotor going. Good Lord. I couldn't have called Edwards and told him I was going to be landing on the big, jumping out and landing on the lake bed. And their people couldn't have gotten to me as quick as this guy did. Anyway, I tell him, "Well, yeah, I'm having trouble collapsing my chute." And he went over and he collapsed the chute and put some rocks on it and came, and he said, "Are you okay? Are you okay?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I think so. I feel all right." And he said, "Well, I saw your buddy come down. I'll go check on him." So while he was gone, I was able to get out of the helmet and the gloves. It's not easy. Usually we have help, you know, before we get take off and after we land. But anyway, he came back and he said, "I'm sorry, your buddy didn't make it." He was, I was devastated. After being going from a low to such a high, and then that was really devastating. But anyway, he said, "I've notified the Highway Patrol and the Air Force and the nearest hospital," which turned out to be Tucumcari, 60 miles south. And So I've got to get you to the hospital. I said, well, no, I want to go see Jim. And he took me over there, and well, nothing we could do, of course. But he said he notified his foreman of his ranch, and the foreman was going to be there and watch after him until the authorities arrived. And, I got in his little helicopter. I wasn't a real helicopter fan. I figured that they have too many moving parts, and not sure they're all going in the right direction. This was 1966. Hughes aircraft, two-place helicopter, real early model. We got in that thing, and I was sitting here, and the airspeed indicator was there. It was, shaking and vibrating and making a lot of noise, and I didn't know much about helicopters, but I knew a lot about red lines, and I looked down here, and the airspeed indicator's here, and the needle is over the red line by about 15 miles an hour. I think the limit was 85, and we were about 100. I'm not hurt. You don't need to really rush at all. Oh, no, I notified them, and they're waiting for you.
What was the man's name?
Mitchell. Albert Mitchell Jr.
You've seen him since, I presume.
Yeah, that later on that summer, we went back to his ranch. Wonderful, wonderful family.
Did he know? He had probably had no idea what you'd been flying in, right?
None whatsoever.
And they reported the accident to the news, but they called it something different, didn't they?
Yeah, I think F-105 or something. But anyway, we got down there okay. I was able to. They were waiting for me at the Tucumcari Hospital, and I was able to call Edwards in the Lockheed Flight Test Office, and they knew that we were missing, gone from radar, and no communication for quite a while. So they thought, well, we had to have been dead because they knew what the circumstances were.
Had anybody ever ejected at such a high speed ever before or since?
No, it was pretty close. Another Blackbird, the D-21 and the,
oh, the D-21.
The mothership.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were about 75,000 in Mach 3 when it happened, but they were able to stay with it until they got to a lower altitude with the forebody in the cockpit.
Now, when was that anyway?
That was July of that year.
Yeah, it was early on.
That was July of 65. They have 6 months after mine, and because Bill Park was flying it, and he said, you know, when you were describing everything to me, it was helpful. But we were able to stay.
Well, with the D-21, it was the drone hit the airplane.
It didn't separate from the airplane.
It didn't separate, so when they fired the rocket off, it...
No, it elevated and came back down.
There's actually a video of that.
There's the chase plane. Chase, the other, there were two motherships configured for motherships. The other one was flying formation. Taking a video, a flight test engineer got some good videos of it.
So did you? What did you? So that's 66. You retired in 86. So you
86.
Had, so you had another 20 years with Lockheed.
Yeah.
And what did you fly after the SR birds?
Well, I just want to finish one little thing.
Okay,
here.
Go ahead, please do. Yeah.
Anyway, Edwards guys thought, we were goners. So they were really happy to hear me about me, and were really, really disappointed about poor Jim. So I told them exactly what had happened as I remembered it, and what the conditions were, and they were able to duplicate it on the Beale SR simulator the next day. It was about this. Let's see. I can't remember the time. Anyway, it was late afternoon their time, probably about 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and they called of course they got a C-130. We didn't have any any clothes or any money or anything, of course. Same thing happened to me one time when I had to land in an alternate field down in Orlando, Florida, and me and the backseater, and you know, just the pressure suit, everything in my locker at Edwards. So the in that case, the wing commander met us. McCoy Air Force Base is one of the designated landing sites if we had an emergency. And the wing commander met us and gave us each a $100 bill and flying suits to put on and go to the BX because he knew we were going to be there for a while, no clothes. That was pretty nice. That was about 4 days. That was another long story. Anyway, getting back to this, they got hold. They duplicated the scenario on the simulator and took immediate steps to avoid this sort of thing and minimize and do not ever fly with any FCG condition. And then the trim drag problem was solved aerodynamically. And I don't know if you were there when they did the wedge, those 2-degree nose up wedge.
I don't remember.
Yeah, that was, well, that was early. But that took care of the trim drag program.
2-degree nose up wedge, what's that?
In the forward, they just did a full body tilt.
So from the aft cockpit forward, they moved the whole body up a little bit, or
yeah.
Oh no! I don't remember all the parameters. I just remember that you couldn't. That we wanted as much FCG as we could get, and we were always transferring fuel. But I thought the limit was like 25. Comes to my mind.
Yeah,
that was as 20, far aft as you could go.
27, I think. And I think we were like 28 and a half or something.
When it happened to you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the combination of events, you know, the malfunctioning inlet control system.
Right.
And the attitude, 35 degree bank, and the speed, the angle of attack, and then the unresponsive inlet control, unable to compensate for all of the things that were working against us, and the result was just beyond the control capability of the airplane, and it absolutely disintegrated.
Right.
They said we were subjected to plus or minus 22 Gs, impact Gs,
wow,
during that break.
Wow.
And when I was trying to get out of my parachute after I landed, I noticed that there was a strange thing attached to me. It was a seatbelt.
It never...
Seatbelt and shoulder harness were still attached and latched.
Wow, that's amazing.
And the seatbelt had shredded on each side. It was 5-inch wide or whatever, nylon seatbelt. 5,000 pound tensile strength had shredded at each adjustment knob on the ship's side. And then the shoulder harness was still attached. And where the shoulder harness attaches back to the seat structure, that was shredded. So I was still strapped in, but I was strapped out because the seat was still in the airplane. The seat never left the airplane. So anyway, they were able to duplicate it and take measures to prevent that sort of an occurrence. 2 weeks later to the day, I was back at Palmdale flying a brand new airplane out of Palmdale, number one flight. And we used to take flight test engineers with us in the back seat on those, or the RSOs in the back seat on the first flight. And this guy was a flight test engineer. He was a good friend. He used to be before that, he was a test pilot with us, production test on the F-104s. Terrific pilot, but we ran out of 104s, and he had to either transfer to air transportation flights, or with air transportation division in Burbank, flying executives around, or be a flight test engineer on the Blackbird. He selected that. And so he was in the back seat on this first flight, and go roaring down the runway on takeoff. Everything looks good. Rotated, and just as soon as I rotated, I heard George in the back seat, Bill, are you there? And I said, yeah, George, what's the matter? He said, oh, God, I thought you may have left. He says, in the back seat. You know how dark that is. No forward visibility. Two little side windows. And they on the instrument panel, there's a caution warning panel with a big red light on it. It says, pilot ejected. And that light came on as soon as we rotated. I thought you may have left. He didn't have a lot of confidence in my confidence. Or my, oh, God.
You had an experience like that, too, didn't you?
Engine blow up on the right side, you know, and we were coming down supersonic descent, you know, single engine, and then the good engine flamed out. At some point, the backseat of the RSO, he was a great big guy, about 6'4 or so. And it's so violent, I can't imagine what you went through, because this one is still flying supersonic, but all the pitch yaw and roll that's happened.
Yeah.
He tried to steady himself, and he pushed on the intercom panel, and he put all the buttons down. So we weren't talking. I'm calling for checklists and telling him what's going on. And he's not answering me, so I'm doing everything that I can from memory. You know, we had already shut down the right engine that blew up, and we're in this descent, and all of a sudden the left generator goes off the line, and I try to reset it, and then the pressure suit starts to inflate, and I realize the left engine must have flamed out. Wow. And I look down, and what I'm looking at, RPM, is obviously just windmill speed. And when the pressure suit starts to flame, or the pressure suit starts to inflate, I'm had to use both hands to pull down the tie-down strap to keep it from going up over my head. And then I go through trying to start the engine, and eventually I jammed it in afterburner, and the engine lit off. I saw the RPM go up. By the time it did that, I had pushed the nose down pretty far. Nose down, I was probably a good 30 to 40 degrees nose down, because I wanted to make sure air's going through there.
Yeah, you bet.
You know, as we're coming down. But it lit right off when I went into afterburner. And right about then, that's when the backseater, the RSO, came back on the comm. And his first question, he said, Maury, are you still there? I got the same thing. Are you still there? And I said, where were you?
Yeah, where the hell were you?
He says, I'll explain later. He says, what do you need? And I said, we lost both generators for a while. I don't have a platform. I'm just flying visual on off the Whiskey Compass. Wow. You need to reset everything. He says, you got to level off. I said, okay, we'll get down, we'll level off. And we did, and I just flew wings level off the horizon, and he resynced the nav system and the INS, ANS, all that stuff. And got a platform back, synced the heading, and then...
You were so close to becoming a glider.
Yeah.
Wow.
So anyhow, then he figured out where Kadena was, and we headed back to Kadena.
Good.
Landed single engine. Yeah.
Yeah.
So Maury, anything you can ask that it would be interesting to?
No, I had heard this a lot of what Bill described in prior things and read stuff about it, and then on that Smithsonian Channel when they did the thing about the SR-71, and they had interviewed you, and they had interviewed me.
Right.
And I got to see that on the TV also. But I don't remember as much of the detail as you described here. I think they, edited some of that stuff out. I'm sure you told them the same stuff. I didn't realize that the airplane had, pitched up so violently, and the G's
It
you
was
went
all
through,
within
yeah,
three seconds, three,
right.
4 seconds.
Yeah, it all happens pretty darn quick.
Wow, yeah.
So that was very, very interesting.
Yeah,
and I can relate to, like you said, your first flight in the A-12 or the SR, whichever it was. I just remember coming out of fighters. I flew F-4s, and my first ride in the B model I thought was sort of anticlimactic, because you took off, you flew around subsonic and went out to the tanker and then did some landings.
Right.
And as you described, the airplane itself is so stable and so
beautiful.
Nice and responsive. Yeah,
really
very
beautiful.
Nice. Yeah. And your first real experience is when you start going supersonic.
Yeah, now you have to pay attention.
Right, right.
Yeah, people ask about Well, the view must be spectacular there as well. It's pretty nice when you have time to look at it.
Right.
There's a lot to do, and
yeah, it's a busy cockpit.
It really
especially
is,
especially when you're getting up supersonic, near the, right?
You're right in the edge of a few envelopes up there.
Right. I did a little bit of instructing towards the end of the first tour, and then in the second tour with new guys coming in. And in the first time before the DAFICs came in, and we were still having on starts, guys were always curious about, you know, that, and it was something I guess made you a little anxious thinking about it, you know, wanting to get over it and have it happen or something, because we bang the simulator a lot,
yeah.
You know, to let them try to get a feel.
It wasn't the same.
No, it wasn't the same. And anyhow, I used to tell the guys that I instructed, I'd say, you'll get your first unstarted about 40 or 50 hours in the airplane. And they never asked why. And finally, some guy came back to me, I don't remember which guy it was, and he said, I had my first unstart, I got 46 hours in the airplane. How did you know that was going to happen? And I said, because you'll be comfortable enough to look outside. And you're going to forget to
getting
do something.
Getting complacent. Oh, that's right. Yeah. Don't get complacent.
Right.
I know.
So yeah. So when the last of the SRs was built, probably in 67, something like that? And,
yeah.
And so what did you do after that?
Well, after the SR program, for me, a couple of the guys stayed on, and Gilliland, they were, through 68 anyway. I was, for the first part of 68, I went back to the real Lockheed, not the Skunk Works, and back to the F-104 and at Palmdale. An engineering test, and they were involved with the F-104S model, which was the latest model, and it was for the Italians only. And they were going through the certification program of this F-104S model. It was an advanced fire control system, advanced everything, and a higher thrust engine. It was a standard. Up to that point, standard F-104G model. I had 17,500 pounds thrust, I think it was.
Ooh, that's a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, ooh. They went to the S model with the J-79-19, and it was 18,000 pounds of thrust. Boy, that really improved the performance except that they get a when they improve an airplane's performance, it seems inevitably they want to put more stuff on it.
Right.
And so the empty weight of the F-104S was probably 120,000, 124,000. And the thrust to weight ratio was almost 1-to-1. Wow. But they put all these pylons on it and bombs and missiles. At the end of that program, as we were doing guarantee flights, I made a takeoff at 32,000 pounds.
Jeez, that's really an increase.
It still got off the runway okay, but boy, what a difference. But on the other side of the coin, that same engine just a standard clean configuration. You know, you get up to Mach 2, take off Mach 2, 40,000 feet in 6-7 minutes. But the U.S. Air Force had some 104A models. They had an Air Defense Command unit down at in Florida. And they were having trouble. They put the big engines in their 104A models. This is one squadron, and they were getting way up to high altitude and having problems at high altitude with flameouts. So they brought one of the airplanes to Palmdale with that big engine, and I got to fly that, and that was really spectacular because the 104A was the lightest version of the production model, and its empty weight was 15,000 pounds.
Oh, boy.
And
yeah.
Here they have a 18,000-pound engine. It was spectacular. Like getting shot out of a rocket. And take off at Palmdale, climb up, and we'd be at Mach 2, 40,000, in 5 minutes. It just wow. Routinely. That was a lot of fun. That's when I went, was finished with the Blackbird and went to back to the Lockheed California Company and spent about a year on the 104S program, this other program. And then in 1969, middle of 69, they dragged me from that over to the L-1011 program, which was just beginning and hadn't flown yet. And boy, what a letdown that was. I was going from years and years of Mach 2 and Mach 3 flying to an airplane that went Mach 0.9. A huge airplane. And I didn't have a whole lot of big airplane experience. Well, really not none, except every now and then going up to the Area 51 from Burbank. Lockheed had Constellations, you know, beautiful old-fashioned four-engine transport. We had three of them. We'd fly from Burbank up to the Area in those something.
Is there still a skunk works?
Yeah, but it's all in Palmdale now. Nothing, no Lockheed in Burbank anymore.
It's where they fly the Aurora out of, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Or whatever.
Been waiting for the Aurora for a long time.
That's right.
Well, so you went on to fly. We're kind of running out of fuel here on this thing and energy and everything else. But you flew in the Pegasus project.
That's right. Yeah, I was with the L-1011 from the very beginning until I retired. Middle of 69, preparing for the first flight and. I flew on the fourth flight of the L-1011. They had a first flight crew through the first three flights, and then I got on the fourth flight and I flew.
Well, the Pegasus started in the early 90s, didn't it?
It started in 92.
You know what that is?
Well, actually, it started in 90, but NASA flew the Pegasus. The original Pegasus drops were
it's
from
a
NASA,
B-52. They drop it off the 1011, puts 1,000 pounds in orbit.
Yeah, it's a big rocket, 50,000 pound, 55 feet long, 5 feet in diameter, 22 foot wingspan. The vertical fin goes up into our airplane, up into the L-1011.
Really?
And we drop it at 39,000 feet, Mach 0.8, whatever we can get out of it. And 10 minutes later, it's got satellites into our
airplane. That must be something to see fire off of your airplane.
It's impressive, yeah. We've had, especially night.
Yeah, that would be something to see.
Yeah, there. We get a great view. When we drop it, it's about 5 seconds after drop. The stage, it's a three-stage.
Oh, really?
Stage one lights off. And in the meantime, when we drop it, we're in a specific heading. You got to be within plus or minus 3 degrees because they don't want this have to make big corrections. Drop it, 5 seconds later, stage one lights off. In the meantime, we lose 50,000 pounds and 10% aft CG shift when it goes.
That's why it pitched up like that.
Yeah, so we go like that.
Yeah, they saw that in the video. Yeah,
it only takes 20-pound force to resist it, but we like that separation. Because when stage one lights off, by that time, five seconds is 500. We've dropped 500 feet, and we've gone up at least 500. They say the debris range, if it blew up when it stayed one, it would be 1,000 feet. We're above that. So anyway, we roll out of that turn. And when we roll out, this thing's gone underneath. It sounds like a train, a big roar.
Well, you can hear it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it sounds like a locomotive going underneath the piece. Then we got a great view of it because in that time it's gone up like a rocket. Got a great view. And like I say, at night it's spectacular. And 70 seconds, the stage one was, stage one ends and stage two takes over. Stage one separates, stage two lights off, and we have a great view of that. And then, but when stage two lights off, it's already at Mach 8 and about 200,000 feet.
Wow. Holy cow.
70 seconds after we drop it. It's impressive.
Wow.
So how many of those drops did you make?
36 so far.
Gosh.
How many did you make yourself?
34.
Oh, 34.
I was there for everyone except two.
Well, but they're still doing it, right?
They're still doing it. We have one scheduled for October 17th.
Well, so you're still involved in some way.
I'm involved, but when I turned 85, this is ridiculous, you know. And the insurer said, you're right.
Well, you're going to be 90 this year, aren't you?
No, I'll be 87.
87. Oh, I thought you said you were born in 26.
No, I am 87. No, I was born in December 28.
Oh, December 28. Okay.
I'll be. Well,
I think I'm about out of video.
Wow, any way to get a ride on that and see that?
It's a real ride.
Just to ride up and...
They just do it all over the ocean, right?
It has to be over water, over the ocean, because stage one, after it burns out, stage one drops back into the ocean. Stage two also drops back. It burns for another 70 seconds.
So they fire it off to the west?
Yeah, we fire, most of them are out of Vandenberg, right up here, and they're all a southerly heading. Those are polar orbits.
Oh, so when something's fired out of Vandenberg, it's not necessarily a Minuteman. It could be one of those things you're seeing.
Could be.
When you're seeing all those trails in the sky.
Yeah, take off from Vandenberg or something?
Yeah, we take off from Vandenberg. As a matter of fact, the Pegasus Final Assembly Building is at Vandenberg.
Oh, okay. So
Pegasus is built in Chandler, Arizona mainly, and then they truck it out here and put it all together at Vandenberg. And then we fly out of
it. I thought it was something they were using a lot to put small, well, 1,000-pound satellite in orbit.
1,000-pound satellite up to low Earth orbit, 400 miles is its capability.
Wow. Wow. So,
interesting.
It's been
you guys
great.
You guys had enough?
Yeah.
By the way, you're married, obviously, right?
Yeah.
And how many kids do you have?
Well, between the two of us, we've been married before. 10. You want to hear about grandkids?
No. I'm going to turn this off. Thanks a lot, Bill. It's great stuff.
Okay.